Language borrowing. Language borrowing lies at the basis of bilingualism. So it is more of a norm rather than something uncommon. So what happens in this translanguaging is that bilinguals actually borrow items from other languages that they know and use them and embed them in the main language they are currently communicating in. So this is a typical form of bilingual interactions, and it is nothing that has to be seen with the criteria of monolingualism in mind. So translanguaging or borrowing other items from other languages does not mean that bilinguals are not proficient in that language. Rather, it is something which is a common practice. This is the way they think. This is how they draw upon different types of languages that they know. Now, what are the different types of language borrowing? Number one, the language borrowing can be morphological. What do we mean by that? Morphological would mean that the inflexes or little changes in a word are made in such a way that the linguistic aspects of two different languages are combined. For instance, when you say rodo pe kaam ho raha hai, and when you say rodo, so road is an English word, and you use this little item of or vau and nun hunna for that. When you say table idhar rakh do, then again you are using the English word table, but you are using the morphological item of ye and nun hunna over here. Now, the borrowing can also be grammatical. For instance, you are using certain items, or the way you are talking is a way in which you are borrowing certain grammatical structures from another language. It can also be phonological, that is related to the sounds of the language from one language to the other. And I often give this example of vau that we use when we are talking about what. It's not what, it's a vowel sound taken into what. Actually, what it is it's what, but we hardly ever do it. Similarly, at times, the borrowing can also take the shape of a different meaning for the same word. For instance, when we say registrize in Spanish, it would mean to look for something. And in English, it actually means to register. But when you have Spanish speakers who also know English, then they transfer the meaning of register to the word, to the Spanish word registrarize. Similarly, the transfer or the language borrowing can also take the form of structural change or structural embeddedness. For instance, when you hear people saying, tomorrow I will come to see you, that is actually a structural transfer or borrowing from Urdu language into English language. In English, actually, we say, I will come to see you tomorrow. So the time adverb comes towards the end of the sentence and not at the beginning of the sentence. However, what you are doing is you are saying, kal main tumhe milne aaunga. All right, and then we come to this lexical borrowing, that is very, very common. You use certain items which signify certain things, and you borrow them into the language you are using. And if you keep on using these items to a greater extent, then they become what we call cognates. So those items become equally acceptable in the language they have been borrowed into. For instance, tables. So even in Urdu books, you might come across, in written language also, you might come across this word of tables or road. Now, these different forms of borrowing are called loans or shifts, and at times they are into one language and at times they are into another language. So you can borrow from English to Urdu and Urdu to English, likewise from Sindhi to Urdu and from Urdu into Sindhi. However, at times it is happening so fast and it is almost back and forth that it is difficult to tell which language are you actually speaking. Now, this back and forth switching of languages has also been called code switching. Please remember, code switching is a part of translanguaging, and it is not that translanguaging is a part of code switching. So, to language in a specific way in which you're borrowing items from other languages is a category within translanguaging.